Buses are inseparable elements of the fabric of our cities. The social life of an urban bus thus reflects the social life of our contemporary cities. This is certainly true in a city like Bengaluru that is rapidly making the transition towards personal automobility, even as buses remain the single largest people mover. Bengaluru is a rapidly growing metropolis in south-central India on the Deccan Plateau. It is the capital of the Indian state of Karnataka. The city, which was formerly known as Bangalore, is now a burgeoning city of about 10 million people. It is governed by the Brihat Bengaluru Mahanagarapalike, or the BBMP.
I think the city has metamorphosized fundamentally. So it's not just an incremental change which most metropolitan areas undergo. This has become something else. During the 90s, significant changes took place in terms of the real estate policies, which kind of opened up almost every neighborhood for different forms of development. In addition, there was this huge pressure of expanding the city to accommodate the new wave of investments in IT, biotechnology, and that stream of industrialization. Brought in a huge influx of young people, who with them brought a different kind of sense to the city. So this is what you're now seeing. This is not what Bangalore was even 20, 25 years ago.
In the last 20 years, there have been several changes in Bangalore, you know, which I've also been seeing as I grew up. The whole direction of Bangalore's growth and any developments in Bangalore seem to be in a way that it makes it easier for the technology industry to conduct business without any consideration for the fact that, you know, whether these changes work for the residents of the city who might or might not be employed with the technology industry. There's a lot of speculation around land, and I think this is one of the primary reasons as well for like the number of changes which we see in Bangalore. Several tanks have been sacrificed for real estate. The areas around the tanks have been converted into illegal layouts. The whole city is being monetized, the space is being monetized, land is being monetized. Essentially, the city is kind of become out of reach.
I remember coming back to Bangalore after a gap of lapse of 20 years. And I was struck by the changes. The single most, I think, factor that caused this kind of a radical change was the government policy in the mid-90s to build Bangalore as another Singapore. Our chief minister then, S.M. Krishna, initiated a policy of rapid globalization in a way. Flyovers and road widening schemes, signal-free corridors, all of these gradually came to change the character of the city completely.
The new forms of urbanization did not comprehend the need, the demand of public transport. And there was public transport, but it was not great. There was a lot of delay in terms of building the bus transit systems to meet the demands. And there was this huge messed up thinking amongst the bureaucracy that one should not subsidize public transport, and it has to pay for it on its own. That kind of thinking actually delayed major reforms in public transport and investment in bus rapid transit systems. And by the time they got up to it, the crisis had actually hit almost all neighborhoods. Traffic jams, which are unimaginable today, could never be anticipated even in the 90s. But one does have to lay the blame squarely also on the corporate sector. There are many, many things they could have done. For instance, in the 60s, when the public sector era was, launched in the city, maybe 200,000 or 300,000 workers came in. But we never felt an impact of their presence here, because almost everybody traveled by buses, and the buses were provided by the public sector company. And here with these new companies, the new wealth, which were $1 billion, multi-billion dollars company, it would have been a fraction of an investment for them to invest in their own buses. Instead, they started poaching on the buses from the public transit system. So the regular travelers suffered, the IT workers got privileged, and there was a crisis of public transport also. So it's a really complicated story. It's not a simple one.
So one direct impact of this growth in the city was on the transport system, in the sense that public transport became more and more a matter for the state to decide who are the people it was going to serve. More and more, the state government decided to introduce two classes of travel. One for the large majority of the population, and another for the growing middle class.
I think the worst affected are the poor, because there is also this whole idea of making bus systems viable financially, right? As a result, the capacity to pay is not marked on the capacity of the poor person to pay. Instead, it is of the person who can travel to government jobs or corporate jobs. That willingness to pay is seen as the barometer for pricing a bus ticket. The poor don't just travel, they also need the bus for many other services. A vendor carries his vegetables. Today, the way in which the fare system has been developed is an active refusal to carry a passenger, which is the antithesis of a public transport system.
What we see is that more and more of Bangalore is a sought to be gentrified, if I may use that term. Airport. Where all the services and the entire system is geared towards satisfying the needs of this middle class population. So public need is slowly being replaced by private gain. The urban poor are losing their right to the city, And by doing that, you know, the policy makers are reinforcing the character of Bangalore as a millennial city.
Bangalore has a shortage of 1,000-2,000 buses, and this BMTC has been saying for the last 2 years, but you know, those buses have not come through yet. The number of bus commuters in the city is increasing. In the sense, the people who want to use the bus is increasing. But if you see, the commuters actually has come down in the last year or two because of the increase in BMTC fares. In the last 3 years, BMTC fares have gone up by between 40% to 75%, putting even the ordinary bus out of reach for several people. There are several people who, like, you know, people who go to domestic work, people who are into security or cleaning, who walk short distances. They walk 3 to 4 kilometers because they can't afford even that much, right? 3 to 4 kilometers would mean 12 rupees or sometimes even 14 rupees for the bus one way. Two way will be 28. It's out of reach.
Major infrastructures in Bengaluru are governed not by BBMP but are managed by special public corporations. For example, intra-city transportation is managed by the Bangalore Metropolitan Transport Corporation or the BMTC.
ಇವತ್ತು ಸಾಮಾನ್ಯ ಬಸ್ಗಳಿಗಿಂತ ಹೆಚ್ಚಿನ ಓಲೋ ಬಸ್ಗಳನ್ನ ಖರೀದಿ ಮಾಡ್ತಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಓಲೋ ಬಸ್ಸು ಎಷ್ಟು ಜನರಿಗೆ ಬೇಕಾಗಿದೆ, ಎಷ್ಟು ಸಾಮಾನ್ಯ ಜನರಿಗೆ ಅದು ಜನ ಓಡಾಡ್ತಾರೆ ಅದರಲ್ಲಿ. ನನ್ನ ಒಂದು ಅನುಭವ, ನಾನು ಕಳೆದ ಒಂದು 5 ವರ್ಷಗಳಿಂದ ದೊಮ್ಮೂರು ರೂಟಲ್ಲಿ ನಾನು ಕೆಲಸ ಮಾಡ್ತಿರೋ ಕಾರಣ ದೊಮ್ಮೂರು ಸೈಡ್ ಹೋಗಿ ಬರ್ತಿದ್ದೀನಿ. ಇಲ್ಲೇ ಇದೇ ಶಿವಾಜಿ ನಗರದಲ್ಲಿ 7:30 to 9:30 ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಮುಂಚೆ ಆರ್ಡಿನರಿ ಬಸ್ಸಸ್ ಇರುತ್ತೆ. 7:30 to 9:30 ಒಂದು ಆರ್ಡಿನರಿ ಬಸ್ಗಳು ಬಂದರೆ ರೇರ್ ಬರುತ್ತೆ, 1 hour ಇಲ್ಲ 1/2 hour. ಉಳಿದ ಎಲ್ಲ ಬಸ್ಸು ಓಲ್ವ ಆಗಿರುತ್ತೆ. ನಮ್ಮ ಹತ್ರ ಇರೋದು ಆರ್ಡಿನರಿ ಪಾಸು, ನಮಗೆ ಕೆಪಾಸಿಟಿ ಇರೋದು ಆರ್ಡಿನರಿ ಟಿಕೆಟ್ ತೊಗೊಳ್ಳೋಷ್ಟು ನಮ್ಮ ಹತ್ರ ಕೆಪಾಸಿಟಿ ಇದೆ. ಇವತ್ತು ನಮ್ಮ ಹತ್ರ ಇರುತ್ತೋ ಇಲ್ವೋ ಆದರೆ ಖರ್ಚು ಮಾಡ್ಕೊಂಡು ಆ ಬಸ್ಸಲ್ಲಿ ಹೋಗೋ ಹೋಗಬೇಕಾದಂಥ ಪರಿಸ್ಥಿತಿ ಇವತ್ತು BMTC ನಮಗೆ ತಂದು ಒಡ್ಡಿದೆ. ಆದರೆ ಓಲ್ವ ಬಸ್ ನೀವು ನೀವೇ ಗಮನಿಸಿ ನೋಡಿ, ಇಬ್ಬರಿರಲಿ ಆ ಬಸ್ ಹೋಗ್ತಾ ಇರುತ್ತೆ ಬರ್ತಾ ಇರುತ್ತೆ. ನಮ್ಮ ಹಾರ್ಡರಿ ಬಸ್ಸಲ್ಲಿ ಕುರಿಗಳು ದನಗಳು ತುಂಬ್ದಂಗೆ ತುಂಬ್ಕೊಂಡು ನಾವು ಹತ್ಕೊಂಡು ಹೋಗಿ ಹೋಗ್ತಾ ಫುಟ್ಬಾಲಲ್ಲಿ ನಿಂತಿತ್ತು ಇವತ್ತು ಹೆಣ್ಮಕ್ಳುಗಳು. ಆದರೆ ಯಾಕೆ ಇವತ್ತು ಈ ಹೆಣ್ಮಕ್ಳು ಇಷ್ಟು ಕಷ್ಟ ಓಡಾಡ್ತಿದ್ದಾರೆ, ಜನಕ್ಕೆ ಇಷ್ಟು ತೊಂದರೆ ಆಗ್ತಿದೆ ಅಂತ ಯಾರೂ ಕೂಡ ಗಮನ ಕೊಡ್ತಿಲ್ಲ.
BMTC did start something called Atal Sarige, which is supposed to be for slums, which is a complete sham because there are only 36 buses and there are at least 1,000 slums in Bangalore. So with 36 buses, which you're saying is meant to address the urban poor and the slums, I'm not sure what you intend to do. The other issue is, in terms of slums and buses, is that several slums are being evicted and relocated to relocation sites outside the city where the bus facility is really poor. This is a big problem which is faced by the urban poor in the city. Neither are the slums inside very well serviced. I mean, of course, we don't have all the data, but the Atal Sarvege doesn't work. People who have been relocated, very poor bus facilities.
Slum olagade busgalu hogtilla. Before 1 kilometer, 1/2 kilometer indene stop kodtana alle nilkondu nadkondu hogbekagutte eshtu ella slum janaru kuda. ಅಟಲ್ ಸಾರಿಗೆ ಅಂತ ಸ್ಲಮ್ ಜನರಿಗೆ ಅಂತ ಬಿಟ್ಟಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಆ ಬಸ್ನ ಒಂದು ರೂಪುರೇಷೆ ನೋಡಿದ್ರೆ ಗೊತ್ತಾಗುತ್ತೆ ಎಷ್ಟು ತಾರತಮ್ಯ ಮಾಡ್ತಿದ್ದಾರೆ ಇವರು. ಡಿಪಾರ್ಟ್ಮೆಂಟ್ಸೇ ಆಗಲಿ, ಒಂದು ಸರ್ಕಾರನೇ ಆಗಲಿ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ಬಿಟ್ಟು, ಮತ್ತು ಅವ್ರು ಹೇಳ್ತಾರೆ ಅದ್ರ ದರ ಕಮ್ಮಿ ಅದಕ್ಕೋಸ್ಕರ ಬಸ್ನ ಹಾಕಿದ್ದೀವಿ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ಬಿಟ್ಟು. ದರ ಕಮ್ಮಿ ಆಗ್ಬೋದು, ಅವ್ರು ಎಲ್ಲಿಂದ ಎಲ್ಲಿಗೆ? ಇವಾಗ ಯಾವುದೋ ಒಂದು ಏರಿಯಾದಿಂದ ಕೊನೆಗೆ ಶಿವಾಜಿನಗರಕ್ಕೋ ಮೆಜೆಸ್ಟಿಕ್ಕೋ ಹೋಗಲ್ಲ ಬಸ್ಸು. ಇಂಡಿಯನ್ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪ್ರೆಸ್ ಲಾಸ್ಟು. ಅದೇ ಒಬ್ಬ ಒಂದು ಕೂಲಿ ಕೆಲಸಕ್ಕೆ ಹೋಗೋರು ಒಂದು ವ್ಯಾಪಾರಕ್ಕೆ ಹೋಗುವಂಥ ಜನ ಏನು ಮಾಡಬೇಕಾಗುತ್ತೆ, ಇಂಡಿಯನ್ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪ್ರೆಸ್ಸಿಂದ ಮತ್ತೆ ಬೇರೆ ಕಡೆಗೆ ಅವರು ಟಿಕೆಟ್ ತೊಗೊಂಡು ಬೇರೆ ಇನ್ನಷ್ಟು 12 ರೂಪಾಯಿ 25 ರೂಪಾಯಿ ಟಿಕೆಟ್ ತೊಗೊಂಡು ಮತ್ತೆ ಬೇರೆ ಕಡೆ ಇಳಿಬೇಕಾಗುತ್ತೆ. ಇವ್ರಿಗೆ ನೇರವಾಗಿ ಒಂದು ಬಸ್ಸಲ್ಲಿ ಹೋಗುವಂಥ ಸ್ವತಂತ್ರ ಕೂಡ ಅವ್ರಿಗೆ ಇನ್ನೂ ಸಿಕ್ಕಿಲ್ಲ. ಹತ್ತಬೇಕು ಇಳಿಬೇಕು, ಇವ್ರಿಗೆ ತಾರತಮ್ಯ, ಇವ್ರಿಗೆ ಅದು ಬಸ್. ಯಾಕೆ ಅದೇ ಬೇರೆ ಬಸ್ ಥರ ಲಕ್ಸುರಿ ಬಸ್ಗಳು ಬೇಕಾದಷ್ಟು ಲಕ್ಸುರಿ ಬಸ್ ತೊಗೊಳ್ತಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಯಾಕೆ ಅದರಲ್ಲಿ ಯಾವ್ದಾರು ಒಂದು 2-3 ಬಸ್ ಯಾವ್ದಾರು ಒಂದು ಹೊಸ ಸ್ಲಮ್ಗೆ ಹಾಕಿದಾರೆ ಕೇಳಿ. ಇವತ್ತರೆಗೂ ಯಾವ ಸ್ಲಮ್ಗಳಿಗೂ ಹೊಸ ಬಸ್ಗಳಿಲ್ಲ. ಇನ್ನೂ ಕೆಲವು ಸ್ಲಮ್ಮಲ್ಲಿ ಮಿನಿ ಬಸ್ ಓಡಾಡ್ತಿತ್ತು, ಹೇಳ್ತಾರೆ ಇವ್ರು ನೆಪ ಹೇಳ್ತಾರೆ ಒಳಗಡೆ ಹೋಗೋದಕ್ಕಾಗಲ್ಲ ಅಂತ. ಮಿನಿ ಬಸ್ಗಳು ಎಷ್ಟೊಂದಿದೆ, ಯಾಕೆ ಮಿನಿ ಬಸ್ಗಳನ್ನ ಇದನ್ನೆಲ್ಲ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ಸಲ್ ಮಾಡಿದ್ರು? ಮುಂಚೆ ಮಿನಿ ಬಸ್ಗಳು ಓಡಾಡ್ತಿತ್ತು.
BMTC wants to have a good image. More than anything else, they're worried about that image. So the Volvo buses are there. And then you have these TTMCs. Some of them are like really swanky with these glass facades, which are again not required. It doesn't really serve the commuters. You look at Shantinagar TTMC. It looks swanky from outside with a glass facade and all that. But you go inside, it's really dingy. A recent report by the Karnataka State Pollution Control Board has said that the amount of carbon monoxide levels in Shantinagar TTMC and other TTMC is more than 4 times the permissible limits. This whole change in BMTC has come because of 2 reasons. One is, earlier it was called BTS, Bangalore Transport Service, which is a part of KSRTC. It is also a service. Now BMTC has become a corporation. It's become Bangalore Metropolitan Transport Corporation, which is a company. And then you have the entire concept of revenue and profit and loss, which has come through. So BMTC always has a need to show that they don't have a need to show that they're making huge profits, but they always have a need to show that they're not making a loss. But this is completely illogical, right? Because this is a public transport body. The second reason is the fact that technocratic decision making or technocratic policy making as a rule is kind of spreading across the country, you can say, and definitely so in Bangalore, you know, which is the hub of the IT industry. BMTC today has a toll-free number for grievances, and there you can send them an email, but you can't approach a single desk in any of the TTMCs to lodge a complaint. You know, they don't have that facility. And when you ask them, they say, well, people can send an email, but how many people in Bangalore are going to send an email? Or they say, oh, they can call the call center. But you know, call center is also not something which everybody is comfortable with. They've done a good thing of putting up all their routes online. They put up information kiosks. But you know, what is the way in which you reach information across to ordinary commuters every day? When you change a route, you don't notify them. When you change a bus stop, you don't notify them. So everything you want to do is electronic. Everything you want to do is online. And thereby, people who don't have access to digital media are cut off, right? So the digital divide really plays out starkly in the bus sector, like it does elsewhere in the city. Those with access to technology can use it more easily, and those without find it difficult. We have the Bangalore Metro coming up. There is no doubt that when you have a metro, you can go from point A to point B very fast. Nobody can dispute that, or the fact that it is comfortable. The question is, does it serve well for a city like Bangalore, right, which is radial in nature? Did you want a metro, or did you want a bus rapid transit system, or did you want a commuter rail or something else? And then you're saying, for example, there is no money to set up new government PU colleges. Recently, the Chief Minister said there's He denied 250 crore grant to the education department to set up new colleges because there was no money. There is no money to set up public hospitals. But you have 38,000 crores to spend on, like I said, one part of one problem, that is transport, of only one city, Bangalore. Is this really justified? The importance to buses has come down because there's more importance given to the metro than to the bus. And how do I say this? I say this in terms of, one, do you give priority to buses in terms of funding? Absolutely not. Like I've already pointed out, there's a huge lopsided subsidy given to the metro and none to BMTC. Do you give priority to buses on roads? No. And several of the changes we are seeing in Bangalore are because of a lot of these big ticket projects, you know, mega projects. One is the metro. Then there is a push for signal-free corridors. Why do you have a signal free corridor? So that the cars can travel faster. Cars don't have to stop. And they're saying signal free corridors are being done to prevent traffic jams. But what caused the traffic jams in the first place? The cars. And what are you doing now? You're making it easier for the cars. And what happens when you have signal free corridors? One, you cut down a lot of trees on the side. There are very few street vendors. The very nature of the street is changing. Streets are being remodeled in such a way that it serves only transport and only a certain type of transport. These new roads are not good for cyclists, they're not good for pedestrians, they're only good for motorized vehicles.
ಇಲ್ಲೇ ಶಿವಾಜಿನಗರ ವ್ಯಾಪಾರಿ ನಾವು ಸುಮಾರು ಒಂದು 55 ವರ್ಷಗಳಿಂದ ನಾನು ಫುಟ್ಪಾತ್ನೊಳಗೆ ಜೀವನ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇರೋದು ನಾವು ನಾನು ಮಾತ್ರ ಅಲ್ಲ ಸುಮಾರು ಒಂದು 300 ವ್ಯಾಪಾರಿಗಳಿದ್ದಾರೆ ಈ 300 ವ್ಯಾಪಾರಿಗಳನ್ನು ಅವ್ರವ್ರ ಬಂಡವಾಳ ಹಾಕ್ಕೊಂಡು ಅವ್ರು ವ್ಯಾಪಾರ ಮಾಡಿಕೊಂಡು ಅವ್ರು ಜೀವನ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ ಇದು ಬಿಟ್ಟರೆ ಬೇರೆ ಯಾವ ಗತಿ ಇಲ್ಲ ನಮಗೆ ಫುಟ್ಪಾತೇ ನಮ್ಮ ಜೀವನ ವ್ಯಾಪಾರಿಗಳಿಂದ ಪಬ್ಲಿಕ್ ಏನು ತೊಂದರೆ ಇಲ್ಲ ಒಬ್ಬೊಬ್ಬರು ಜನಗಳಿಗೆ ತೊಂದರೆ ಇಲ್ಲ ಇಲ್ಲೆಲ್ಲ ಶ್ರೀಮಂತರು ಯಾರೂ ಬರೋಲ್ಲ ಎಲ್ಲ ಬಡವರು ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಬರೋದು ನಾವು ಬಡವರು ಇಲ್ಲಿ ದುಡ್ಡು ಇರೋರು ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಕಮರ್ಷಿಯಲ್ಗೆ ಹೋಗ್ತಾರೆ ಅವ್ರು ಅಲ್ಲಿ ತೊಗೊಳ್ತಾರೆ ವ್ಯಾಪಾರ ಮಾಡ್ಕೊತಾರೆ ನಾವಿಲ್ಲಿ ಬಡವರು ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಬಡವರು ವ್ಯಾಪಾರ ನಮ್ಮನ್ನು ನಂಬಿ ಬಡವರು ಬರ್ತಾರೆ ಬಡವರು ನಂಬಿ ನಾವಿದ್ದೀವಿ 15 ದಿನಕ್ಕೊಂದ್ಸಲ ಬಸ್ ಬೆಲೆ ಹೆಚ್ಚಿಸ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ ಜನಗಳು ಹೆಂಗೆ ಹೋಗಬೇಕು ಬಡವರು ಕೂಲಿ ಮಾಡೋರು ಒಂದು 50 ರೂಪಾಯಿ ಕೂಲಿ ತೊಗೊಳ್ತಾನೆ ಅವನು ಬಸ್ಸಾಗಿ ಹೋಗಬೇಕು ಅವನು 30 ರೂಪಾಯಿ ಬಸ್ ಕೊಟ್ಬಿಟ್ರೆ 20 ರೂಪಾಯಿ ನೋಡಿ ಮನೆ ಜೀವನ ಹೆಂಗೆ ಮಾಡ್ತಾನೆ ಈ ಸರ್ಕಾರ ಗೊತ್ತಿಲ್ವಾ ಇದೆಲ್ಲ ಸರ್ಕಾರ ಕಣ್ಣಿಲ್ವಾ ಇಲ್ಲ ಗಮನ ಇಲ್ವಾ ಅವರಿಗೆ
It's difficult for women even more. The type of commutes they do, you have to get up very early in the morning and come late in the night. And the way buses are, they aren't really structured for safety, they're structured for mobility.
ಮೊದಲನೇದಾಗಿ ಸ್ಟಾರ್ಟಿಂಗ್ ಹಿಂಸೆ ಶುರುವಾಗೋದೇ ನಿರ್ವಾಹಕರಿಂದ ಚಾಲಕರಿಂದ ಶುರುವಾಗುತ್ತೆ ಹಿಂಸೆಗಳು ಅವರ ಅಸಭ್ಯ ವರ್ತನೆಗಳು ವ್ಯಂಗ್ಯವಾಗಿ ಮಾತಾಡೋದು ಒಂದು ಗೌರವ ಇಲ್ಲ ಮಾತಲ್ಲ ಏ ಪಾಸ್ ತೋರಿಸೆ ಅದ್ರಲ್ಲಿ ಬಸ್ ಹೋಗ್ಬೇಕು ಅಂದ್ರೇ ಎಲ್ಲ ಒಂದು ಕಡೆ ನಮ್ಗೆ ಯಾರಾದ್ರೂ ಬೇಕೇನೋ ಒಬ್ಬಳೇ ಹೊಂಟು ಹೋಗಿ ಕಷ್ಟ ಆಗ್ತಿದೆ ಅನ್ನಿಸುತ್ತೆ ಒಂದೊಂದಲ್ಲ ಪರಿಸ್ಥಿತಿಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಮೇಜರಾಗಿ ಹೇಳಬೇಕು ಅಂದರೆ ಮುಖ್ಯವಾಗಿ ಮಹಿಳೆಯರ ಸೀಟುಗಳು ಬಂದು ಪುರುಷರು ಕೂತ್ಕೊಂಡಿರ್ತಾರೆ ಎಷ್ಟು ಇರೋದೇ ಅದರಲ್ಲಿ 8 ಸೀಟು 7 ಸೀಟು ಒಂದೊಂದು ಬಸ್ಸಲ್ಲಿ ಇರುತ್ತೆ ಅದನ್ನು ಕೂಡ ಬಿಡಲ್ಲ ಹಿಂದೆ ಅಷ್ಟು ಜಾಗ ಇದ್ರೂ ಬಂದು ನಮ್ಮ ಮಹಿಳೆಯರ ಸೀಟಲ್ಲೇ ಕೂತಿರ್ತಾರೆ ಹೊರತಾಗಿ ಒಂದು ಸೌಜನ್ಯಕ್ಕಾದ್ರೆ ಒಂದು ಹೆಣ್ಮಗಳು ನಿಂತಿದ್ದಾಳೆ ಒಂದು ಮಗು ನಿಂತ್ಕೊಂಡು ನಿಂತಿದ್ದಾಳೆ ಒಂದು ಮಹಿಳೆ ಬಂದಿಲ್ಲ ಅನ್ನೋ ಒಂದು ಸೌಜನ್ಯಕ್ಕಾದ್ರೆ ಎದ್ದೋಳಲ್ಲ ಅಷ್ಟು ಒಳಗೆ ಎಷ್ಟು ಹಿಂಸೆ ಇದೆ ಹೊರಗಡೆನೂ ಅಷ್ಟೇ ಮಹಿಳೆಯರು ಕಷ್ಟಗಳನ್ನ ನೋವುಗಳನ್ನ ಹತ್ತುಕೊಂಡು ಒಂದು ಟಾರ್ಚರು ಇನ್ನೂ ಬಸ್ ಬಂದಿಲ್ಲಲ್ಲ ಅರ್ಧ ಅವರ್ ಆಯ್ತು ನಾನು ನಿಂತ್ಕೊಂಡು ನಾನು ಮನೆಗೆ ಹೋಗಬೇಕು ಟೈಮ್ ಆಯಿತು ಮನೆಯಿಂದ ಬಯಸ್ಕೊಳ್ಬೇಕು ಅನ್ನೋ ಒಂದು ಎದುರಿಕೆ ಒಂದು ಭಯ ಒಂದು ಕಡೆ ಇದ್ದರೆ ಕತ್ಲಾಯ್ತು ಅನ್ನೋ ಒಂದು ಭಯ ಒಂದು ಕಡೆ ಇದ್ದರೆ ಇನ್ನೊಂದು ಕಡೆ 10 ನಿಮಿಷ 5 ನಿಮಿಷ ನಿಲ್ಲೋದೇ ಕಷ್ಟ ಬೆಂಗಳೂರು ಸಿಟಿ ಅಂತ ಇರೋ ವಾತಾವರಣದಲ್ಲಿ ಶಿವಾಜಿನಗರ ಆಗ್ಬೋದು ಮೆಜೆಸ್ಟಿಕ್ ಆಗಿ ಮಾರ್ಕೆಟ್ ಇಂಥ ಅದರಲ್ಲೂ ಕಲಾಸಿಪಾಳ್ಯ ಇಲ್ಲಿ 10 ನಿಮಿಷದ ಮೇಲೆ ನಿಂತರೆ ನಮ್ಮನ್ನು ಅವ್ರು ನೋಡೋ ಮನೋಭಾವನೆಯೇ ಬೇರೆ ರೀತಿ ಇರುತ್ತೆ ಒಟ್ಟಾರೆಗೆ ಹೇಳೋದಾದರೆ ಒಬ್ಬಂಟಿಯಾಗಿ ಇವತ್ತು ಬಸ್ ಸ್ಟ್ಯಾಂಡ್ಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಬಸ್ಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಬಸ್ ಸ್ಟಾಪ್ಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ನಿಲ್ಲೋಕ್ಕಂತೂ ಖಂಡಿತವಾಗ್ಲೂ ಸಾಧ್ಯ ಇಲ್ಲ
BMTC has now set up a women's safety committee. And we are also part of the committee. And we must say that we appreciate the fact that BMTC set up this committee and they're trying to take steps to make it safer for women. And it's not only BMTC which can solve this problem, you know, this is a larger societal problem, which we agree. But one easy way for BMTC to solve this problem is to put more number of buses in the peak hours. But again, the technocratic policy making I spoke of comes here. And they put CCTV cameras. You have 6,600 buses. How many cameras are you going to put? One camera per bus is not sufficient. You have to have at least two or three. And do you really think a camera can capture everything that goes on in a bus? And who is monitoring the cameras? Who's going to monitor 12 to 18,000 cameras?
Yes, there are more buses, far more buses than before. But no, they're not really as accommodative of the multitudinal needs of the different types of people who live in the city.
One of the principal issues, when you say does BMTC have the potential to address it? It has the potential, but to actually address these issues, see, it's a governance question. BMTC is a city transport body which is not answerable to the city government, that is the BBMP. It is answerable only to the state government, right? And there is no way for people to interact with BMTC to hold them to account. If I want to hold a depot manager to account, if I want to hold the MD to account, how do I do it? The only place they can be held to account is in the assembly, where the MLAs have to raise a question. But in the assembly, there are several issues of across the state which are there. How much time can you give to BMTC? So ultimately, BMTC has to move to a kind of arrangement where BBMP has some accountability over BMTC, where corporators and residents can have some say over BMTC. So if BMTC has to address some of these issues, this governance question is something which has to be urgently addressed.
Rather than a means of moving people, the life of city buses reflects the complexity of urban social relations. Urban buses are thus novel vehicles to shape our cities in positive and progressive ways.
Tremendous improvement is possible in BMTC. I think BMTC is just waiting to erupt into such fantastic innovative possibilities. Not just the big buses, small buses, going to small lanes, picking up people, integrating systems, making sure you don't have to buy a ticket every time, having a single, you know, fare card, which is affordable to all, like in metro systems. I mean, really making people move. Yes, if there is a loss in that, I will absorb that loss. Rather than looking at the loss of fuel, of people sitting inside cars and waiting at traffic light. That is a far greater loss than putting people in buses and making them move. You make the buses move, you make the buses smaller to go into smaller neighborhoods, you don't break the city down for roads. You adapt the buses to the city. You adapt transport systems to the city.
What kind of city do we want to have? How should people in the city move? Should they rely on public transport or be dependent on private transport? Should public transport be affordable and safe for everyone? What level of comfort should all people expect while commuting by public transport? How can governments support affordable and safe public transport? Raising such questions is an effort to take seriously the social life of city buses.